What do you want? I'll just stay here and tighten the vices on my shoulder.
Chosen One, how did you get here? Careful, do not touch the glow wall. I think the machine that feeds it is beneath us. Destroy it so we may escape. How did you get here? If you destroy the machine, we will find the ship. Hurry, there are not many of us left. You must destroy the machine and kill the devils in this place. We will meet you outside. And Chosen One, if you have not found the Gek, seek it here. Our freedom is nothing if we cannot save our village. Now go.
Thank you. Hello there. Glad to make time for one of our gallant troopers, but I am rather busy, so, what can the President of the United States of America do for you? You really don't know, do you? Let me tell you about mankind's salvation. A little history first. Simple. Navarro is an isolated base. Our vertebrates have a limited range. They refuel there. A little history. There was a great war, long before we were born. Our gallant soldiers fought from the Yukon to the Yangtze. We were winning, too. And then those damn Reds launched. We barely got our birds up. Well, no, it didn't. But at least it knocked the damn Red menace back into the Stone Age. Well, no. No, not quite. You see, we had planned ahead. We were ready. We had a number of sanctuaries that would enable the glorious American civilization to endure. This facility, the vaults, were part of the great plan. Actually, they worked almost exactly the way they were supposed to. You might call it a social experiment on a grand scale. The vaults were set up to test humanity. Some had not enough food synthesizers. Others had only men in them. Yet others were designed to open after only 6 months. They each had a unique set of circumstances designed to test the occupants. Vault 13 was a special case. It was supposed to remain closed until the subjects were needed. Vault 13 was, in scientific parlance, a control group. An unfortunate and unforeseen accident. However, as it turns out, a rather fortuitous one. As it turns out, we needed test subjects from untainted pre-war human stock, your ancestors in Vault 13, and some freshly mutated stock, the villagers from Arroyo. For the project, it's almost ready. Humanity's salvation is almost at hand, and the United States of America will be the progenitor of that rebirth. The only way for true humans and democracy to be safe is to cleanse the mutants from the globe. We humans will take back that which is rightfully ours. I'm sure you think so. But tests performed on your tribesmen have all shown that you are guilty of mutation, and it's a damn good thing the project is ready. Some of the members of your tribe are showing some extremely interesting changes. If the danger to true humanity weren't so great, I would think about studying them, but that's not to be. The project will cleanse all the mutants from our fair land and the rest of the globe. Once again, America will be the world's policeman. We found a research facility in operational shape about 70 years ago, a former military base that had been used to research a special virus. Yes, the FEV virus. It was originally developed to turn soldiers into super warriors, but it failed. The warriors were tough and strong, but far too stupid. However, our brilliant chemical corps altered it. To turn it into a staggeringly effective killer. Any humanoid that isn't inoculated against its effects before its release will die. That is the project. No, that's humanity's last best hope. That's what we've been working towards all these years. But that's one of the advantages of the FEV virus. We can release it right here, and the jet stream will carry it worldwide. It'll have plenty of time to cleanse every nook and cranny of the globe. Test subjects?
Your villagers are all descended from Vault stock, and we had to make sure that the FEV toxin was still effective. The subjects from Vault 13 test that, and an inoculation against the FEV. It's hardly necessary. I'm sure we could, and it would work, but there's no reason to do so. Never. Part of the President's job is to make the tough decisions. A lot of near-humans will sacrifice their lives for the return of humanity. Humans will prevail. Oh, I don't relish this decision. If there was another way... But there isn't. No price is too high for the survival of the human race. If you were human, you'd feel the same way. Yes, I do. Even killing me won't help you. There's nothing you can do to stop the release.
Thank you.
You're back. What is it you want?
Thank you. one here. You and your muty bastard friends are gonna join me in a big old mushroom cloud send-off. I just triggered the self-destruct. The work will go on. You didn't do nothing here except seal your own death warrants. Duty. Honor. Courage. Semper Fi.
After the Enclave's destruction, the refugees of Arroyo and Vault 13 resettled, building a new community with the aid of the Garden of Eden creation kit. Finding themselves hundreds of miles from their vault, the members of Vault 13 chose to join the villagers in establishing a new community, and their technical expertise, combined with the villagers' survival skills, allowed the new settlement to grow and prosper. Two generations of the same bloodline were reunited, and their savior, the Chosen One, became elder, presiding over the village in the years to come. Relations between the Slags and the residents of MODOK flourished. Between the two peoples, MODOK prospered and became a major farming community, supplying all the outlying regions with food. With Metzger gone, slavery disappeared from the area. Becky's casino bar grew quickly, and Rebecca Dyer's reputation as an honest casino and bar owner brought her the business needed to buy out her competition and expand. The den flourished, and it soon gained a reputation for being a tough but honest community. In the years following the destruction of the Enclave, Vault City continued to stagnate, choking on its own isolationism. Its Vault 8 generator, which was never intended to support such a large population, prevented Vault City's necessary expansion. Eventually, the city was absorbed by NCR, which had spread steadily northward since its founding. Not long after the destruction of the Enclave, the Bishop family of New Reno was blessed with a child. This child seemed to have little in common with the Bishops, preferring instead to spend his days exploring the wastes. When he turned 13, he seized control of the Bishop family and led them to victory over the remaining New Reno families. He died quietly in his sleep at the age of 73, never having known his real father. Though the Wright family never completely recovered from Richard's death, the knowledge that their killer had been brought to justice eased their troubled sleep. Optimizing Gecko's reactor created a power surplus in Gecko. The Vault City Council, unable to expand because of their limited power supply, yielded to internal pressure and was forced to take over Gecko to control the reactor. The peaceful ghouls of Gecko became slaves and spent the rest of their lives serving Vault City. After Doc Johnson helped treat the miners during the Great Jet Scare, the citizens of Vault City voted Doc Johnson into the mayor's seat. Under the doctor's patient hand, Redding forged closer ties with Vault City until, some years later, Vault City annexed Redding, granting Vault City citizenship to only 10% of Redding's population. With the destruction of the conspiracy to destroy the mutants, Broken Hills began to thrive. Then, the uranium ran out. The city, having lost its sole reason for existing, slowly dispersed. The residents carried their riches with them, leaving the place a windswept, desolate ghost town. A few holdouts remained, attempting to eke out a pathetic existence, but eventually, they too disappeared. Your help with Vault 15 launched the New California Republic's push to civilize its neighbors. Though there were many more obstacles to overcome, the NCR now had a foothold into the northern wastes. With the support of the New California Republic, the Vault 15 squatters soon became self-sufficient and productive members of society. The Xi flourished, creating a botanical scourge on the radiation surrounding their beloved town. Though this vine could not grow in other soils, the Xi took care to nourish it in their lands. They continued to grow in strength and prominence, forming the basis of a new empire. As for the tanker Vagrants, well, as Vagrants do, they drifted on.